In this video, we're going to be reading an article and also writing some code alongside with it to better understand the article that is all about React-informed data, which is becoming more prominent in the context of modern React. I promise you, there's some good nuggets of information in this video and that you're going to be a better developer at the end of it. Now, before we get into that, I just want to mention that if you like these types of videos and you like the way that I teach in my videos and you're also serious about learning React, then you should definitely check out my course, Project React, which goes way beyond what I teach in any single video and actually teaches you and shows you step by step on how to build a big and complex project with React. It uses a custom application that I honestly haven't seen anyone else do, and all the students that have been on the course so far are loving it and they're not regretting it, and they're much better React developers, and I honestly wish this the same for you. So if this sounds interesting to you, check it out. It's called Project React. It's going to be the first link in the description. All right, so here we go. React and form data. So this article is written by Brett Westfall, so shout out to him. We actually read one of his previous articles in the series here on the channel, and you guys have loved it, so this is going to be more of the same. And actually, this article comes from our newsletter, Import React, which is completely free, and you get articles like this and other tips and tricks, it's really high quality, to your inbox every single week, completely for free. If you're interested, again, it's called Import React, you're also going to be able to find it in the description. Learn React's newest and yet oldest standard for accessing form data and the tricks to use it with TypeScript. So when you learn how to access form data in React, historically, you would have learned about controlled and uncontrolled fields. Later, you might start to use third-party abstractions like Formic or React Hook Form, which employ controlled or uncontrolled techniques under the hood. Either way, the end goal is to collect your form's data. With controlled, your data is in your state. With uncontrolled, you need to collect the form data yourself, and devs usually choose refs for that, right? So we have an example here. We have a function on submit. We have an event over here. We're preventing the default behavior, which is something that we have to do on client-side JavaScript. And then we're using refs over here to get the actual value. So let me actually show this how this looks like in code to get a better example and understanding of what he's writing here. So let's come here. Let's remove this cause and solutions, and let's do something like input type. And then we're going to make this equal to text. We're going to give this your name like this, and we're going to give this your, I don't know, username. And we're going to close the input. And here, let's put all of this in a form just for good measure, because we're going to use this in the future. And let's put another input, or let's just keep it for one just now. And now to actually get access to this value in an uncontrolled component, which means that we're not using state for this at all. We're just using the actual input itself. We have to use a ref and actually pass a ref to this. So we can come here and we can do a const input ref, and actually maybe, let's do input ref, use ref. We're going to import this from React, and we're going to pass this here. What is the value of input ref? I forgot it right now. Let's see. Ref, and it's HTML input element. So we're going to do HTML input element. There we go. And now we can put input ref. And now let's do something. Why is it complaining over here? It has to be null, right? That's it. It has to be null. There you go. And now let's just put a button over here to do button. And we're going to do here submit like this. And when we submit, we're going to on submit like this. And here we're going to do E. We're going to get this event here. We're going to do E.preventDefault just like the article. And we're going to console.log input ref.current like this. Current question mark dot value, I believe. There we go, dot value, right? So now let's see how this works. Let's go to our application over here. We had the input. Let's open up our console over here. Why are there so many errors? What happens? Extra attributes from the server. Okay, let's ignore these errors. It's totally fine. Let's do something. Test, submit, and there we go. We have test in our console. That is how you would get in an uncontrolled component. You use a ref, you pass it to your input, and then you access the value directly using the input. This uses no state at all. All form fields in React must either be controlled or uncontrolled, because you're either adding a value prop or you're not, right? So by the way, if in the example of a control component would be something like you come here, const, and that would be username, set username like this, and then we're going to do here use state, import this from React, give this here a string, and here instead of the ref for a controlled component, we would pass it here value username, and then on change we would do something like E, and then we would set username e.target.value like this and save this. And now again, actually, to get the value instead of here, we would just console log username like this. And now we have a controlled component. We're not using the ref anymore. We can come back here. We can refresh, clear this error again. And now we do test, test, and it works exactly the same way, right? Same concept, same example, controlled versus uncontrolled components. Form data, a JavaScript standard since 2010, is a way to access your form's data, whether it's uncontrolled or controlled. But most are preferring uncontrolled. Even though form data has been possible to use with React since the very beginning, we've seen its popularity spike in the last few years. Later, we'll show you how it's being adopted and pushed by more modern React 19 features. Now, this is actually a very important point. So form data is something that, as the article says, has been around since 2010, but we haven't really used it all that much in the days of single page React applications, because mostly we did things with just JavaScript, right? We had to basically prevent the default behavior of the browser and use our own custom JavaScript to fill in that behavior, because that's how React applications were built. And even me today, I'm mostly a React native developer, and I also don't get to work with form data all that much. But that is slowly starting to change now with React 19, where we're starting to ship a lot less JavaScript, and we're starting to go back to more traditional methods, like just traditional HTML elements who do work with form data. With form data, you don't need refs to get the values of uncontrolled items. Instead, you can just read the form values directly off event.target. So here we have the same function on submit, the same event. We still do event.preventDefault, but then we get form data equals new form data event.target. And now to get the values, we do form data.getName and then form data.getEmail. I think this is a typo. Yeah, he forgot a string over here, but that's totally fine. So for example, in our case, we can get rid of here the username. We don't need this. We can just get rid of all of this, get rid of the value and the onChange. And now here, instead of doing the ref, we can also get rid of the ref. We're not going to need this. As long as we have a name property on the input, we can just get it via form data. So we can do exactly that, const form data equals new form data, and then e.target like this. And now we can do console.log form data.get and then username like this. And we should have, oh, this is an error. I believe we have to use current target like this. Yeah, there we go. Now we get no errors. And now we can come here and we can have, again, clear the errors. We can do test. And now we get the same value through form data, right? So again, form data does the same thing. It's just a different API. For certain reasons, TypeScript complains if you use event.target and wants you to use event.currentTarget, right? That's exactly what we had. Just so you know though, these two can often refer to the same thing, and most often it doesn't really matter which one they use. Totally fine, we used currentTarget, that's fine. But we'll use event.currentTarget now since many React developers are doing TypeScript, which we are. Be sure to add names to the input fields in order for from data to work, right? Exactly, you have to put a name property here because that is how from data actually works. Accessing data without getters. Couldn't we just do something like this to extract all the form data without getters? So for example, form values equals dot 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 form data. Well, no, you can't. The object instance form data is more opaque and it's not the same kind of object we can mix with object literals. If we console log it, we won't see the values either. So console log from data, output form data, and then prototype and a bunch of mumbo jumbo that isn't really useful. Right, if we come here and instead of console log this, we just do console log form data, we're gonna get the same mumbo jumbo over here. Let's do this, and then we have form data. And again, there's nothing here that we can actually use. Back in my early days of like working with React and in the web, I always got annoyed and confused. And I even thought that I should be getting values in form data, and I was confused why I wasn't getting them, because form data, again, I did not know that it functioned differently. I thought that this was just a traditional object. It took me an embarrassingly long amount of time to really figure out form data and actually how it works and how to use it. You can avoid the getters and unpack the values into a more plain object like this. So using object.formEntries. So form values equals object.formEntries, and then you pass it here from data. And then if you console log this, you should get the object directly printed. Great. Let's try it. So we're going to come here. We're going to do const form values equals object.formEntries, and we're going to do form data like this. And now we're going to console log form values like this and see what we get in the console. Do we get better result? There we go. Now we actually have the object, and at least we made some progress. We can see the values logged in our console. Great. However, doing so with TypeScript does not give you the types that you would have wanted, right? So again, we are working in TypeScript. This form values over here has a very generic type that is not really useful for us, right? It has any arbitrary amount of keys over here that can be strings. And then this is going to be form data entry value, right? We don't actually know what this is. If we try to do something like form values dot username, we get no type inference, we get no type checking. And this is basically, in the context of TypeScript, completely useless. Even though the value of an input field will be a string, and if the user types no value, it will be an empty string, TypeScript says that the return value from the getter is form data entry value or null, right? So if you do like form data.get, right? So let's do something like const username equals form data.get and then username, right? We should have the proper type over here, but we don't because again, this is coming from form data and it has no TypeScript support right off the box. This can lead to a lot of messy work to do something simple, like convert the user's input to a number. So, right, this is what you would have to do to actually get proper type safety and actually check that the inputs are correct. I'm only going to look at this last one over here because this is like a multi-step process. But to get the quantity, let's say, right, you have to parse the int of form data.getQuantity, then you have to type alias this as a string or null because it can be null as well, right? And then you have to handle the case where it is null and then default it to zero and pass all of that to parse int to get your quantity. Now imagine having to do this for every single one of your fields in your actual form. This is insane. This would take so much time and would make your code so messy and so easy to make bugs in. With object.fromEntries, it's not even better. They only know it's an object with an unknown amount of string keys with form data entry value values, right? So this is exactly what we've seen, right? That is the type, completely useless in TypeScript. Problems fixed with Zot. Zot is a schema-based JavaScript validator similar to others like Yup and Joy, but unlike its predecessors, Zot was very specifically written to work very well with TypeScript. Since this isn't a Zot tutorial, we'll try to convey Zot's power as briefly as we can. This is key. So Zot, if you don't know, I actually just posted a video last week about Zot. It's a phenomenal library. It's a schema validation library that not only validates your data against any sort of schema that you can create, but automatically gives you all of the types to be able to use in your application based on that schema. It's really a one size fits all. You get the validation and the types in one super easy library that is super easy to use, and it just works and it solves this problem really, really well. The idea of using Zot here is that you'll probably need validation anyways in your application, so why not get better types without assertions, right? There you go. When you pass this opaque form values object into the schema validator, Zot validates it based on the schema that you wrote, which isn't shown here, but I'm going to show you in my example, and then also gives you back your data in a type safe way according to the rules of your schema that it just passed. So let's say that we came here at the top, let's remove these imports over here, and we did const user schema like this, and we made this equal to Z, and then we're going to import Z from Zot.object, and here we did user name, and here we did Z.string like this, right? Now we can use the schema and actually pass our form values into the schema and make sure that this is completely correct, and we're also automatically going to get the types from the schema without having to do anything else. So for example, let's remove this username over here. What we can do here is we can just do const result equals user schema dot safe parse. I'm not going to do any parse to throw errors. I'm just going to safe parse. And here we're going to pass form values like this. And now if we console.log the result, we're going to see here, let's remove this console log. We're going to see what result we actually get. So let's come back here. Let's refresh once again. Give it here a second, let's clear errors. We're gonna do test. And now if we submit, you see that we have success, true. So our validation passed with Zot. And then we have our data over here, which is username test. That's the data that we can use in the application. But the benefit of this is now, if I do if result.success, and then inside of here, I do result.data dot, and I can see username, and it's here typed as a string, right? It's validating my data. It's making sure that it's correct what I expect, but it's also giving me type safety, which is really useful in TypeScript. That's why you want to use Zot as your validation library. So again, if you want to learn more about Zot, I have a whole tutorial video that I just posted last week. It's pretty great. I highly recommend this. I use this in pretty much any of my projects. Form data and React 19. Modern React APIs are encouraging you to use and learn from data as well. In React 19, you can emit onSubmit in favor of action, right? So again, onSubmit is basically when you're using JavaScript to prevent the default behavior and then run your own custom functions. In this case, action is the default behavior of the actual HTML element, which is what React 19 and more modern React is leaning towards. So here we have form action, right? It takes in form data over here, and then we have action, and we pass the form action, the function, and then we can use this function instead. So for example, let's come here and let's change our actual example. Over here, let's do instead of onSubmit, let's first create a function. So we're going to do function form data, and that is going to be a function that receives form data, let's say form data, And here we're just gonna do nothing for now. And we're gonna pass this here on the action property like this, form data like this. And actually let's call this form action like this, just to make it clear. And here we can do form data to make it exactly clear what's form action, what's form data. And then theoretically, we should be able to just take all of this code over here, right, that we have, and then remove it and paste it here inside of this function, because this should be exactly the same. And then we can just remove everything that we have on submit, right? And now this should work exactly as we expect. So if we come back here to our example, we can reload, clear the errors, test, and there we go. We have success true. And then we have our data in exactly the same way using the action property. When React calls your form action function, they'll pass you an instance of form data, right? So this is different than passing the actual event, right? So over here in our action function over here, we get the form data object and not the event, right? We're not doing event.preventDefault because we don't have access to event. We just have directly the form data, and we just took all of this code that we had before to be able to work with the actual same form data that we had in the onSubmit previously. We see similar usage of form data in React 19 hooks like useActionState, right? So useActionState works directly with form actions, and again, it's working with form data. There you go. In frameworks, Remix, which will soon be converged into React Router 7, is known for embracing web standards like form data, request, and response. When a form is submitted, its data is available on the server via a standard request instance. According to MDN, you can get form data off the request. This Remix way of handling form data is in line with JavaScript standards. Now, I haven't personally used Remix all that much, but this is what it looks like, right? You have an async function that is an action, it takes in a request, and then again, this is the traditional JavaScript web standard request, and you can do request.formData, await it, get the form data, and then run the same code exactly as we had it before. So this is what I was saying to you. Now, as we're going into React 19 and more modern React, we're going back to web standards like we had them before this crazy wave of single page applications. We're going to start to see a lot more APIs like this being embraced, and we're going to start to see a lot more going back to the bare bones of traditional HTML, CSS, and web standards. And this action over here in form data is a great example of that. If you enjoyed this video and you want to see more videos just like this one, make sure to leave this video a big thumbs up. You can also click here to subscribe, or you can click here to watch a different video of mine that YouTube seems to think that you're really going to enjoy. And with that being said, my name has been Darius Kozdan. This is Kozdan Solutions. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Ciao, ciao.